My wife is going to be so jealous. She loves Javier.
Javier is one of the sweetest guys.
I love that guy's work. I thought Beautiful was amazing.
He's amazing.
Those guys didn't get any love this year, man. No. They should have.
He got his nomination, though.
He got a nomination.
Which was a miracle.
It
was
but like Alejandro should have, and yeah. Rodrigo Prieto was.
He's nominated.
When you were doing Animal Lust Kingdom 3.
How do you know my deep, dark past?
It's scary. Well, IMDb unfortunately knows more about you than
anybody
else.
Of course, I know. It's the rap sheet. Yeah, yeah.
So it was like, you know, someday I'm going to be Mr. Academy Awards. Is that your...
Yes, I was. Someday I'll shoot ladies with their clothing on. It's interesting. When you come out to Hollywood, you know, I came out here to be a cinematographer and to shoot movies, and you end up shooting a lot of different things. I, you know, worked as a video cameraman shooting MTV shows and Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous and all kinds of stuff to put food on the table. And then I shot a bunch of horror pictures. I did Amityville 6. And I did Animal Instincts. I did all these erotic thrillers that were not pornography, but kind of R-rated, you know, they called them erotic thrillers. It was a genre of straight-to-tape.
Skinamax, as we used to
Yeah, exactly. Straight-to-video movies that we made in, you know, the early 90s. That's honestly, that's where I cut my teeth and learned how to light. And learn how to light fast. Mm-hmm. Some of these pictures we did, and I started at Roger Corman's. That was the first movie I ever shot was called The Unborn. Mm-hmm. And
I remember The Unborn.
Yeah, not the one that David Goyer remade last year, but the original one was 1990.
Did David Goyer come to you and say, please come reshoot this?
No, he turns out he didn't ask. you get into all these different things. And at Roger Corman's, we shot movies in 15 days. You know, if you had a big budget one, you shot it in 18 days.
So do you feel like you were part of that family, the Corman whole thing?
I was very much part of that family, yeah. Mm-hmm. I graduated from AFI's cinematography program in 1989. Mm-hmm. And, was friends with Janusz Kaminski, who had been to the school the year before me. Mm-hmm. And Faden Papamichael was a friend of his. And Mauro Fiore was roommates with Janusz. So all the four of us were all working over Roger Corman's, doing everything, working as DPs one day and an electrician the next day, a grip the next day, and shooting second unit and shooting first unit for very little money, but really cutting our teeth and learning how to light and learning how to light fast, learning how to work fast, learning how to come up with fast solutions to problems.
Where were you from?
I grew up outside of New York City. I was born in Chicago, and then my parents moved to New York City when I was young.
And then L.A. was just the shining place to go to be a cinematographer?
Yeah, I think so. I wanted to get in the movie business from, you know, about the time I was 10 or 11 years old. And
Did you always want to be a cinematographer, or did you just want to be in the movie business?
No, I just want to be in the movie business. Mm-hmm. I think I fancied myself a director when I was 11 years old because I had the Super 8 camera, so. Mm-hmm.
Did you make some films?
I did make some films, yeah. We made a lot of movies when we were kids.
And were you just a huge movie fan? Did you see everything?
I was a huge movie fan. I was,
HBO generation, or?
No, pre-HBO, I'm afraid, my friend. This is early 70s, mid-70s. There was no cable television then. It was basically just broadcast television, But I was a television fanatic, too. I watched a lot of TV. Mm-hmm. But really what changed things, there are two kind of pivotal moments in my youth that really got me interested in filmmaking. The first one was my dad took me to see 2001: A Space Odyssey when I was, you know, 7 or 8 years old.
Mm-hmm. A re-release, I guess.
And it blew me. What's that?
A re-release.
Yeah. No. This is 1968. Oh, yeah. Wow. I'm old.
a little bit older than me.
And I dye my hair. I was blown away by that. And really got interested. I was into space because I was at that age anyway. Mm. But I also was really blown away by the film and the experience. Mm-hmm. And then a few years later, on my street, all these trucks started to roll up on the street I lived on outside of New York City in a suburb of New York City. And one truck after another, and I'm like, what's going on? You know, they're coming to shoot a Burt Reynolds movie up there. I'm like, really? And they went up the street to this big castle that was up the street from where I grew up. And Burt Reynolds and Diane Cannon were filming a movie called Seamus. Mm-hmm. And I think it was 70 or 71, I'm not sure. Huh. And so as a 10-year-old kid, me and my buddy snuck up there and peeked through the bushes and watched them filming. And it was pretty exciting. And we caught glimpses of Burt Reynolds. And that was something that really got me going, seeing this huge Mitchell camera out there and all the arc lights and all the crew and the trucks and the excitement of it all and seeing them slate. And so that really got me, you know, as a 10-year-old kid interested.
So do you still like the stuff?
The stuff is still a little bit, you know, there's a little part of us, we fancy ourselves artists, but there's part of us that's still, you know, a bit, you know, into technology and a bit of a techno geek, and, you know, the stuff is still fun. You know, when you now see a great piece of lighting technology for me that actually enhances what I do creatively, then that's pretty exciting, you know. Because I know that it's a tool that I can use. You get less interested in cranes and steadicams and you know, wire rigs and that sort of thing, and you have to really make it about what's appropriate for the story, what's really, you know, the best way to tell what's going on in this scene. Mm-hmm. But you still like, you know, plugging things in and well, soldering.
Somebody's giving you credit for pushing along the IMAX idea for the last Yeah. For Dark Knight.
Yeah, well, I actually don't take credit. I take credit for making it happen, but it was actually, you know, the brainchild of Chris Nolan to shoot on IMAX. Mm-hmm. You know, we had done a release of Batman Begins on IMAX, and Chris and I both loved the way that it blew up and was on the screen. Mm-hmm. But Chris was kind of like, "What about, you know, shooting on IMAX cameras? What do you think?" And I was like, "Well, let's figure it out. It'd be amazing." And so I put a lot of time and effort early on pre-production and The Dark Knight to figuring out, you know, what it was all about and what it meant to shoot with IMAX cameras.
And turned out to be fun to try that? Or
you know, eventually it was. Eventually it was. I wouldn't say it was painful at all. It was a challenge, absolutely. Uh-huh. But by the time we shot the bank sequence in The Dark Knight, which was the very first thing we shot in The Dark Knight, I mean, Chris loves to jump off the cliff with, you know, his hands over his eyes. And we did that in a way with the bank sequence on The Dark Knight. We shot in, you know, in the old post office in Chicago the very first week of shooting. Mm. And it was designed to be in the prologue, you know, to run in theaters before, months before the movie came out. Mm. And Chris's intention was to shoot it all in native IMAX and show it in IMAX theaters. And it really worked.
So back then, around this time in the year, where it was awards time, and we were having cocktail parties with Chris and for the movie, for Dark Knight, the conversation about IMAX for the next one came up, and he was like, no, can't do it.
That's funny.
Because it was so loud, and it was so cumbersome, and it was so whatever. But it seems like, is it true that you guys have figured out a better way to do it, or a more sane way to do it?
We're working on that now. I mean, for Inception, we started having conversations, and Chris wanted to explore large format again. Mm-hmm. And every time I'd walk in his office, he'd say, "Really want to do more on IMAX, and let's look into some of these other systems. Let's look into ShowScan. Let's look into, you know, iWorks. All these other systems."
So Inception just got blown up, right?
What's that?
Inception just got blown up.
Yes,
there was
correct.
No actual shooting.
We shot some 65mm on Inception. Yeah, so that was sort of the mid format.
Right.
But really, you know, he wanted to explore that. So I'd go into his office one day and it'd be like, "Well, what do you think about doing this in IMAX?" And then the next day I'd go in and say, "I really want to do this whole thing handheld. I really want you to put the camera on the shoulder and follow the action around," and which I loved as well. And then finally, you know, I would go in his office the third time and say, "Look, we can't handhold the IMAX camera. You want to run around with it handheld, which is the language for the film that you really want to embrace. Because I don't think the two are working together. I think so we eventually moved away from IMAX for that, you know, and decided to do a much more of it in this visceral style with the camera on my shoulder and kind of chasing around. And pepper in a little bit of large format. So we shot Panavision's 5 perf 65mm system for large format, which is about double the size and resolution of 35mm. Whereas IMAX is about nine times the size of regular 35mm.
Will there ever be such thing as a digital IMAX?
They do have a digital IMAX system, but Chris and I don't like it. Not compared to the film system. The film system is still much, much better. There's nothing quite like it. In fact, it is the highest resolution image available.
And you are kind of one of the film holdout guys.
Yeah, Chris and I are real film guys.
You guys and Spielberg are kind of the only ones left.
Yeah, well, I don't know. There's still plenty out there. I know that Brad Bird is, shooting parts of Mission Impossible 4 in large format. And, I've had conversations with him, and he's a huge, film holdout and a large format, fan. So there are a group of us out there who realize. and my whole point with 35mm film is the digital technology has not gotten as good as it.
Right.
So as long as we have a superior capture medium with 35mm film, why would I use, the acrylics rather than the oil paints? Maybe that's not a good one. Why would I use, I don't know. I don't know what the comparison is.
Well, it's an interesting debate because it does seem like a lot of DPs have actually, the high-end DPs have gotten their head turned.
Yeah. I think people are embracing a lot of this stuff. I know Roger Deakins is shooting with the Alexa camera right now.
Yeah.
Airflex is digital. And he likes it a lot. And a lot of people feel that's the most advanced system. Mm-hmm. But it's still not 35mm film. It's still not the equivalent. It's not just the fact that 35 is closer to 8K and there's no digital 8K camera, but it's also the physical depth of the layers on film that give it the contrast, that give it the color saturation. Mm. And it's the simplicity of it for Chris and I. All we really have to plug into that film camera is a battery and we have to load a magazine of film on there.
Right.
You have to plug so many plugs into, the digital cameras, and it has to be run to a DIT, and a DIT sitting there turning, knobs, and my point is, I started out as a video cameraman. I know this technology from the earliest stages. I was using video cameras in 1980, so I know this evolution very, very well.
Right.
And when I started shooting film, I saw the difference immediately, and now these cameras have evolved quite a bit, but I still see a difference. And I understand the difference.
Probably happy not to be shooting the softcore on video.
Yeah, that would be kind of pure softcore.
Well, they kind of, the porn
business.
They
have to do that now, keep a camera rolling that way. It's a little cheaper,
Well, the porn business kind of went to Blu-ray for about 3 seconds and then realized nobody really wanted to see that much detail.
The porn business went a weird way at a point. I remember when DVDs, and it was before Blu-ray, that's true, isn't it? Before Blu-rays came out, the porn business was getting into that scene thing, so you could choose all these different angles and stuff, and I was like, oh my god, this is getting a little weird. Personally, I don't watch pornography.
Well,
I prefer the real thing, but
But I mean, for everything,
personal preference.
Yeah, we know way too much about way too many people.
Right.
Thanks to video, it's a little different animal.
Yeah,
so, how do you approach a movie like Inception? I mean, this is a rather complicated palette, to say the least.
Yeah, yeah.
A lot of directions going on at once.
Yeah, yeah. Well, my approach, it begins the same as any big picture with Chris, which is really I just start to break down the script myself. I my first read of the script is really just as a viewer, sitting back or as a reader and sort of, reacting to it as as an audience member. And then I read it, the subsequent passes or just start breaking it down and coming up with questions, really. My process with Chris is I just make pages and pages and pages of questions. And I walk into his office and say, what was your thought about doing this? What do you think about doing this? How do you want to handle this? I was thinking we could do it like this. What do you think? Blah. And we just tick them off bit by bit. So you break it down, and becomes, you shrink down, what is sitting in front of you as this massive, daunting project, and you take little bites out of it until it's a manageable size. And then really, it's easier for me to start thinking creatively after all those sort of logistical and once I'm in Chris's head and I understand how he sees it on the screen. And so for me, one of the sort of challenges creatively was to break this into different looks.
Mm-hmm.
And particularly later on, when the film is intercutting between, right. you know, the ski slopes of Calgary and, you know, a tumbling hallway mm-hmm. and a van on a rainy street in Los mm-hmm. Angeles, it's important to distinguish looks between those three elements.
So and do you think automatically like that when you're reading something? Like an actor may start breaking down character issues.
I don't think about that the first time I read.
Right.
Later on, I start to think about it. And sometimes it's a bit of an epiphany. Sometimes it's like, oh, I know what I have to do here. And then I'll go to Chris with it and say, what do you think? He's like, mm-hmm. yeah, man, that's great. Or I was like, no, that's not what I was thinking.
Does he ever get talked into anything? Do you talk him into it?
Yeah. They're always negotiations, you know. look, Chris is a great, great, strong visionary guy, mm-hmm. but he's also a great collaborator. And he would be foolish to hire people like myself, mm-hmm. people like Lee Smith, his editor, people like Hans Zimmer, you know, the composer, people like Nathan Crowley, his production designer, mm-hmm. and not listen to their opinions. And that's why he has us around. That's right. why he's had us around for many, many years. I've been mm-hmm. with Chris for 12 years now. I give him ideas and suggestions, and he uses them or he doesn't use them, mm-hmm. or they evolve. But it is a strong creative process, and I think that he feels that he's able to get the best material that way, by you know choosing what he wants from his mm. you know his field generals.
So does the amount of CG in this movie change your job significantly?
Boy, it's funny. Everybody asks that so much. I think the interesting thing is, it's the perception of how much CG is that's in this movie. I think is more than
there it really is.
If you go back and look at this film, mm-hmm. most of it's in camera. The CG sections are the folding over the Paris streets,
right.
you know, that are very obvious. A lot of that stuff in Paris in general,
right.
You know, near the end, jumping off the, you know, out of the window and mm-hmm. falling in, the Limbo City stuff.
Right.
There are not that many sequences that are pure CG like that. Mm-hmm. And so for me, I don't even recall so many of those being, you know, so much of the film being CG. I just remember shooting the action bits and then shooting the emotional bits with the, you know, between, you know, Leo and Marion and Ellen. And then of course the main action set pieces have almost no visual effects in them. Mm. If you think about the zero G hallway and the fight in mm. in the hallway, that's a completely mechanical effect. That's a physically tumbling hallway. The only right. visual effect in that is wire removal.
Did you go look at Fred Astaire movies? Or?
You know, we didn't look at Fred Astaire movies, definitely in the back of our minds, mm-hmm. as was 2001. Mm-hmm. Funny, you know, going back to that, considering mm-hmm. that was, you know, so influential to me, and then a half generation later to Chris. That was a lot of the thinking. Mm. But the mechanical execution of these things, you know, the visual effects are spectacular, as you know.
Yeah.
And to do something like fold over the street of Paris can only be done in visual effect and mm-hmm. makes sense in that realm. But our physical and mechanical effects are as prevalent in the film. So in terms of how I handle that stuff, I don't see it as a visual effects film. I mean, you know, Tron is a visual effects film.
So when the stuff is done with the CG, for instance, like Bending Paris,
mm.
are you talking to the guys who are doing that as well, or is that
yeah
Chris
we're very closely linked with the visual effects, and Paul Franklin was the visual effects supervisor, mm-hmm. and he and his team did a phenomenal job, and that folding over the street, they started very early on because we shot that pretty early on in the shooting schedule,
mm-hmm.
and Chris wanted to give them plenty of time to really really get that effect the way that that he wanted it to look,
mm-hmm.
and the buildings crumbling in the sea later on, and some of that stuff is just stunning visual effects work,
mm-hmm.
I get involved in that all the way back. To Batman Begins, I've been involved mm-hmm. in the visual effects stuff in that they send me still photographs and comps
mm-hmm.
and I help guide them in terms of the lighting and the color
mm-hmm.
To match our original photography. Mm-hmm. And when we're on location, I'm very mindful of giving them all the plates they might need,
right.
Of making any part of it simpler for them to do in the amount of time. But Chris really throws a lot of challenges at them as well.
Yeah.
He doesn't want our camera really to cater to the visual effect at all. Mm-hmm. So you'll see in the scene where the Paris street folds over, it's all handheld. Mm-hmm. So it all has to be rotoscoped. It's all got to be tracked in. There's nothing simple about it for the visual effects compositors. And,
just to make it look simple.
Exactly. And Chris is basically, his instructions to me are, let's shoot it the way we would shoot any other scene. Mm-hmm. And then they'll have to figure out how to do their part.
So is it more fun shooting people in a rotating room or on a street somewhere?
definitely fun shooting them in a rotating room. You know, it's a blast. I mean, when we shot that rotating hallway, you know, we had a techno crane, which is a telescoping crane, mm-hmm. poking into the hallway, and the hallway is revolving around it. And we also had a camera fixed to the floor on a track who was mm-hmm. able to dolly across the floor mm-hmm. as the set tumbled, as the actors bounced off the wall, you know. And Joseph Gordon-Levitt is, you know, not only a phenomenal actor, but an incredibly fit, you know, athlete. Mm-hmm. And the stuff that he pulled off and the bruises that he, you know, had to endure to get mm-hmm. that scene on film, mm-hmm. just incredible.
So how did you two kids meet in the first place?
Me and Chris?
Yeah.
I
Hollywood's great marriages now.
Yeah. It's really turned out that way. I had done a film. I've been bashing around in the erotic thrillers, the horror movies, and I got a little sick of that stuff. Mm-hmm. And so I started working as a camera operator on bigger movies. Mm-hmm. And I worked on three with John Turteltaub. I did While You Were Sleeping, mm-hmm. Phenomenon. I guess maybe it's just those two with him. And then I did another film called Unstrung Heroes that Diane Keaton directed.
I love that movie.
It's great, isn't it?
That's like
really
one of the great lost movies. Really,
I know.
I never see
and
it
And it made
10
cents in the theater, too. Yeah. It was a disaster from the box office
standpoint. Great performances.
Really great. John Turturro, Andy McDowell, yeah. You know.
The great friend, what's his name, just died, the Canadian...
Did he die?
The uncle, yeah.
Oh, Maury?
Maury Jacobs.
Oh, I didn't know he died.
Passed away a few months ago, yeah.
Oh, Maury was a great actor.
Yeah.
I didn't realize that. That's terribly sad.
Yeah.
God, he was lovely. But so I worked as a camera operator for a number of years, mm-hmm. you know, because I was tired of doing the crap films. Mm-hmm. And while I was doing that, we were doing Phenomenon, and the sound mixer on the movie was a guy named Ron Judkins, had written a screenplay, mm-hmm. And asked me to shoot this low-budget, you know, independent film for mm-hmm. him. And the film, we made it for $300,000. Shot it in the winter in Montana on film. Mm-hmm. Rachel Lee Cook starred in it. It was called The High Line. And so this showed at Sundance, got into mm-hmm. competition at Sundance. It was our first venture there. And while I was there, I met Chris Nolan. Hmm. Chris saw the film.
Chris was there with Insomnia?
He was there. No, this is well before. He had only done one film.
Then
he did Following.
Sorry.
That's all right. He did Following, and that was at Slam Dance.
Right.
We briefly met, didn't really make much of a connection.
Right.
But a year later, he was putting together Memento, and I think we had a mutual agent as well, and they mm-hmm. sort of put us together, and he saw Highline and liked the work that I'd done on Highline.
Another lost movie, sadly.
Another lost movie, definitely, yeah.
I don't think it ever got distributed.
It did get distribution because I have a DVD of it.
Yeah,
but
I finally got it, but it took a while because they won awards, didn't they?
It didn't win
anything.
Did
Rachel win something?
But it did get it. Not at Sundance, but it did get into a few festivals, so it got out there a little bit. But
that
once again,
that was your Todd Field head in the bedroom there. And
that's right. That was around that same time. God, you got a good memory.
Well, I remember Rachel Lee and him being at the same space, sitting next to each other.
That's a great memory because I think that was 98 or 99. Yeah. 98 it would have had to have been. Because 99 is when I met Chris, and so he hired his. The way I like to tell the story is his first five choices weren't available, so he hired me to shoot Memento, and the rest is history. This is number 7 that we're going into. Is that right?
Did it feel like something was happening when that all came together?
Yeah, I think so. I think it was really clear. Look, he'd never used a DP before. Mm-hmm. He'd never used an editor before. I think he cut the movie himself. The mm-hmm. Following, he did everything on Following. And so it was an interesting experience, but a great experience. And I love the I loved the script of Memento. I'm not sure I understood it completely, but I loved it. And I actually related quite a bit to it because the Sammy Jenkins character and Leonard Shelby both have this dementia. And my father had this dementia at the time and still does. And so I was really able to relate to that and emotionally. So it was a great experience shooting that. And then actually when Chris hired me to shoot Insomnia, which was the next film we did together, it just kind of went to the next level. I think we both took our experiences from Memento and were able to better that. And I think that's continued to do that. I think that each film that we do, each subsequent film, the relationship is stronger, our communication is better, the process is simpler, and continue to be successful. So
do you feel like a much different cameraman through this process?
Yeah, I do. I do. When I go back and look at the work, I there were times when I thought the work I was doing now is so much better than what I was doing back then. Mm-hmm. But when I go back and look at Memento, there's a raw quality to it. I'm a naturalistic lighter. I don't light in a stylized way. I don't use smoke and backlights, and I like natural light. So when I go back and look at Memento, I think there's a raw quality about it that reflects my taste, and I think Chris feels the same way. If you look at the film, I don't know whether it looks like an independent film or not. I don't know what the what it looks like, but I know it doesn't look overlit.
Right.
And that's always what I've strived to do. Yeah. If you look at anything that I've shot, and you go, oh God, there's too many lights, or it's overlit, or it's too bright, or whatever else, then I've failed as far as I'm concerned.
So is that harder on a film like Prestige, where you have period to deal with and all that?
It's easier on Prestige because it was easier to make Prestige look good because there was so much great inspiration. The inspiration of shooting a period piece anyway is really fun. Textures that you're not used to filming, wardrobe that you're not used to filming, and then working with firelight rather than incandescent light, or sort of right at the advent of incandescent light. So that's really exciting. And then once again, that folds in naturally with the natural light, the use of natural light in windows. I think probably Prestige was the most fun picture for me to light from that standpoint.
Then should the audience notice that you're doing these things that are more challenging to you, or should we be?
No. Movie? The audience should be following the story, and hopefully, if something pops off as looking beautiful, there's a reason in the narrative that it's supposed to look beautiful. There's a reason it's supposed to. If it's too dark to see, then there should be a reason you're having trouble seeing it. Mm-hmm. No, I don't think the audience should necessarily be aware of the photography. Mm-hmm. I think the photography is there to serve the story, and the performances.
So when you guys were doing Inception, did you have a sense while you were doing it that it was going to become this worldwide monster hit?
You start to get a little used to that with Chris Nolan. He manages to write, and I knew it reading the script too. The action.
You couldn't imagine on Dark Knight that it was going to be that much bigger than.
No, Dark Knight was a bit of a surprise.
Batman Begins.
Dark Knight exploded.
Yeah.
And none of us were really ready for that. And everything about it just kind of snowballed and turned into this massive thing. So following A Dark Knight, we knew sort of whatever Chris was going to follow up with was going to have a lot of notice and was going to have a lot of eyes on it. In terms of how it was going to be received, who really knows? But when I read Inception, I loved the screenplay and I knew it was something special. And I knew I was very happy to not be doing a superhero movie, and also thrilled about the cast in that picture too. Mm-hmm. So everything about it was a little different from the Batman pictures, but we approach it in a similar way. And there are still huge action set pieces, so I knew he was putting enough out there,
right.
For the summer audiences to bite into. Mm-hmm. The film made nearly $1 billion, like the previous one had, and that I think shows, it's not just that, that Chris is a brilliant filmmaker, but also that he's able to have pretty massive appeal. And sadly, I think that that becomes a liability around awards season. You know, the film is so brilliantly crafted, and the fact that Chris wasn't nominated for a Best Director, you know, nod in the Academy is shocking to most of us.
Yeah.
And that his editor Lee Smith wasn't nominated either. It's really inconceivable. But I think that there is probably a bit of a snobbery, you know, towards a film that makes nearly $1 billion.
Well, I think there's also a, you know, there's an age issue. I think the Academy is a very specific group. And it's not better or worse, it just is. And I think
for
whatever reasons that Impromptoir, that it's the answer, kind of gets overstated when it's the answer for this particular group of 6,000 people.
Yeah.
Who have a certain age and a certain
mindset. True, and I said that to Chris too. I said, look, I think that you have the younger generation really responds to your film. They really seem to, and he said, but I'm 40. And I said, well, that's young. According to me, that's young. But it's sort of funny. He doesn't realize. But you know, there was an article, and I'm not sure I believe this, and I don't think Chris believes it, but an article that mentioned that, you know. That older audiences have a harder time. When I say older, I mean over 65, over 70, have a harder time tracking Chris's material than younger audiences. Now, both my parents are 82 years old. My mom tracked it perfectly, got everything, loved it, loved the way he wrote it and structured it and everything else. So,
what I wrote after hearing from some Academy members right after the movie had been shown to them was that it was loud.
Yeah,
and they just did, they just kind of turned off.
They do make loud movies, I'll tell you.
But they just
we do make loud movies.
Tuned out to that. It's not.
Yeah,
you know, which isn't really reflective.
It's a little. It's a little tricky. It's a little tricky. Both, I think, both Chris and Lee Smith as editor like to keep the volume up. Really loud, and some people have a hard time with that. I love it because it draws me, and it's part of the experience. But I have a daughter who always watches the screenings like that because it's just too overbearing. But that's part of the visceral emotional experience for Chris, is putting it out there, putting it in your face.
Well, I think somebody
with the sound like we do with the camera, you know.
Somebody enjoyed it out there.
Oh, a lot of people did.
So is it strange to go off with Bennett Miller, and does it feel like you're cheating on Chris?
That's so funny. It kind of did a little bit, you know, it did a little bit. But God, completely different filmmakers, completely different kind of filmmakers, you know. And Bennett is still very much, you know, dug into the indie world, and I really like that. You know, he brought that... he brought that independent spirit with him into Moneyball, and that was really that gave me a lot of inspiration there too, you know. And I can't wait to see what he's doing in the cutting room, because I think he's going to keep that spirit going. And it's a great story. I think it's a popular enough story so that the you know, that audiences will respond, and it should do well. And it's Brad Pitt, so and Jonah Hill.
Very hard to shoot Brad Pitt, I'm sure.
What's that?
Very hard to shoot Brad Pitt, I'm sure.
Oh, gosh, guy just, you know.
So many bad angles.
Oh, no, he's amazing. Amazing dude. And he lives that character in the movie. And then the others, Jonah Hill is just wonderful. And playing, you know, not playing a pure comedic role, you know. But still has his sense of humor in there, but is playing a fairly straight role. And then Philip Seymour Hoffman is mind-blowing. That guy is like... He's a phenomenal actor.
So do you get surprised when it gets cut together with what it is?
Well, you know, having never worked with Bennett before, I don't know. It will be interesting. I don't know what direction he'll go from what we shot. With Chris, I'm always somewhat surprised, but also I know his process pretty well. I know how he thinks. I know, you know, what we've gotten on film pretty well. So... yeah, surprise is an interesting word. Yeah, I don't know. I've been satisfied. Touch wood. Every film I've seen, I've been, you know, I've been surprised. You know, at how wonderful it is. You know.
And you and Janusz ever call each other and decide to, you know, switch partners?
Me and who now?
You and Janusz Kaminski.
Oh, yeah.
You think I'll do a Steven and let him do a Chris?
No, we never talked about that before.
Because you both become had these marriages, really.
Yeah, you know. Yeah, it's true, yeah.
He
doesn't
even bother shooting other movies. He mostly shoots
commercials. No, it's true. Well, he's been sort of exclusive to Steven forever. Yeah. He did do the movie with...
with
Well, who are we talking about?
Julian Schnabel.
Thank you, Diving Bell, which was gorgeously shot too. Yes. I really love what Janusz did on that. Yeah. Julian Schnabel
he
thing.
He got nominated.
But yeah, he did. Yeah, yeah.
Which yep. Now Janusz is a challenge. Sometimes.
He's got two statues.
He's got enough.
He don't need no more. Yeah, he's fine. But yeah, he's still a good friend, and I'm still very close to Fade and Papa Michael, and and Mara won the Oscar last year. We're all still, you know, still friends, and you know. It's amazing. We all started out together 22 years ago and, you know, have reached these places, you know.
And now it all comes full circle because now the villain in the new Batman will be played by Burt Reynolds. From what I understand.
That's right. Burt Reynolds is coming back. It's going to be all over. Can you imagine that on the internet?
He's playing the Penguin,
I work with Burt Reynolds, man. I work with Burt Reynolds and James Coburn in the same movie. That's
wow.
That was an honor. I got a cigar from James Coburn.
And is it weird to be part of this cult? I mean, is it just weird, like everybody's waiting? You were talking before about you've been in trouble a few times for saying anything about this movie.
Yeah, it's weird for me. I'm a big mouth, so. yeah, it's weird.
Do you feel it in your regular life?
Don't kill me, y'all, but I'm not a big superhero fan. I never have been. So it's hard for me to understand the fanboy thing and the whole, you know, sort of cult behind comic book heroes and all that stuff. I'm kind of a real world guy, you know. Mm-hmm. I like Cops and Robbers, you know.
Which is what he made in the last. I mean,
yeah. Well, Chris turns him into that. Chris crafts, you know, a superhero movie into you know a cop and robber tale or a dark movie. You know, it's like we watched a Sidney Lumet movie, Prince of the City, the other day.
Great one.
And it's a devastating, powerful movie about police corruption in New York. And it's like a Chris Nolan movie. You know, it's like the way he does a Batman movie. It's like that. It's
well, like I love the Burton movies, but they're just a completely different animal.
Absolutely.
And that's great.
Yeah, absolutely. But that's how I see those films. I don't really even see the cape and the cowl and and the Batmobile. You know, I see it as being a real life, you know, drama.
So do you have 18-year-old boys in your garbage cans at night?
I've got an 18-year-old boy living in my house and a 16-year-old girl living in my
No internet connection for the kids.
They're not crazy fan kids either. They're different, you know, sort of things. But no, people are always trying to ask me questions. You know, reporters are always trying to sneak questions about Batman in there and who's the bad guy and who's the villain. And you know, and I lose track sometimes of what's in the press and what's already out there and what I know but it's not out there. But yeah, people are always trying to extract information. But I think the problem is now, I understand it from the fanboy standpoint, but I think the problem is now a lot of people are trying to make money doing it. Mm-hmm. And I sort of resent that a little bit. You know, somebody gets a hold of a piece of juicy gossip, they know they're going to get a million hits on their site, and so they're making money off it. So, you know, it's not as fun as if it's just a fan wanting to know these bits and, you know.
But isn't the fun part of going to the movies, going to the movie, and having the experience and being surprised?
Wait for it.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I don't want to know.
Absolutely. And there's nobody that's better at security than Chris Nolan for that exact reason. He wants to save it. He wants people to go and watch the movie. He doesn't want it to affect, you know, the box office. He doesn't want it to affect the movie. If the script gets leaked on the internet and you've got 5 million people commenting on what they think the screenplay is like before the film comes out, it's not doing anybody any good. And it's, you know, it's a shame if it's going to be a good film. So there's really no need for that.
I'm pretty sure we all want to see Anne in the suit.
Yeah.
Whatever Catwoman's going to look like.
Whatever she wears. Whatever
it's
going to
be
wears.
A good thing.
Yes.
We also love and Other Drugs, and now we're ready for that.
Right on. Right on. Yes.
Thank you so much. And of course,
my pleasure.
You know, you're known as the most handsome cinematographer in Hollywood. So.
Get out of here, really?
That's what I've heard.
Mauro's a pretty good looking guy, and he won last year. That's nice.
Well, I'm up the level.
I'm an old man, but, you know, it's. You know, I'll
holding
be 50
it together
this year.
But you
I'm
can probably still stunt double, what's his name, Crank and Jason Statham.
Oh, Jason,
you can shave your head a little bit. You
could. Yeah, that's nice to know. Handsome Rob. I work with Jason as Handsome Rob in the Italian job. So.
There you go.
That's nice to know. I appreciate the compliment. My wife will appreciate it.